I'm Lieutenant Rasu from the Sheriff's Department. I'm going to start by just giving you a general timeline. Sure. I'm Lieutenant Rasu from the Sheriff's Department. I'll start by just giving you a general timeline of the events that occurred this morning. And after that, I'll introduce you to the other people involved in this incident. You can ask them for more specifics on the fire and the evacuation and more specific information regarding what happened. So the first call reporting this fire was to the Sheriff's Department Emergency Dispatch at 3:15 this morning. The report was that a warehouse at the Adel Co-op was on fire, and a short time later at 3:24 there was a report from that fire scene that the building was fully engulfed and that several explosions were heard. Shortly thereafter, at 3:31, an evacuation of the village, including a one-mile radius around the fire scene, was ordered for the safety of the residents. And the fire was then brought under control over the next few hours, and at approximately 6:30 a.m. this morning, the residents were allowed to return to their homes. The fire had been brought under control by firefighters, and people were allowed to return to the village. For more specifics, I'm going to turn you over to other representatives here involved. We have Adel Fire Chief Will Schneiderwent. We have a DNR supervisor, Joe Jarish, Adel Co-op Manager Gerald Blake, and Village President Andy Schmidt, as well as Representative of Sheboygan County Hazmat Team, Mark Mathias. You can ask them for more specific information regarding what occurred.
Basically, we have 100% loss. What was involved in the fire was our agronomy office, which is our fertilizer plant. We're a farm supply cooperative that have a grain elevator, a feed milling operation, and a mixing operation, and then fertilizer and farm chemicals. And so the buildings that were involved in the fire were a seed warehouse. Basically, this time of the year, the planting season's in the spring, so we have very a limited amount of inventory in those buildings. It was a 50 by 100 wood warehouse that had seed stored in it, a limited amount of, this time of year would be wheat seed, mostly wheat seed in there for winter wheat planting. And then we had a seed treatment equipment down there that was involved in the fire. And also our offices for our agronomy department were destroyed. And we had a chemical warehouse, and again, a very limited amount of inventory down there, but we did have some, a small amount of extremely hazardous chemicals, farm insecticides that were left over from the spring store down there, and some farm herbicides. So there was, obviously concern to limit any damage to the environment off our facility here. The fire department did dike up the culverts that we have that run underneath the railroad tracks and keep the water in the ditch, drainage ditch that's in that area. And in the process right now, I believe, of getting somebody in here to start cleaning that up. And they did, contain the fire. For the explosions they talk about, basically, there were two 120-gallon propane tanks that were used to heat the agronomy office. And as you apply heat to those things, they're designed, they have pressure relief valves on them. As those relief valves, as the tanks heated up, they're steel tanks, they released vapor to the air, and those, those relief valves went off. That's what the noise was that they're calling explosions. I don't believe that the tanks actually bloodied, that actually exploded. I didn't witness that myself down there, but very loud, and of course, big high flames, because there's that vapor on those propane tanks, goes out of the tank, it ignites, because there's, a fire was down there and it ignited, and then you had the tall flames coming up. And they also had a propane fired forklift down there, which I'm sure, was involved in a couple empty or full forklift 30-pound LP tanks. So it was, the noise that they heard down there, they reported as explosions, were those propane tanks that were located down there. They didn't really explode, not that I witnessed, but very loud, and of course, when they go off, it's a whistling sound, very loud sound down there. And, when they're fighting the fire, it's a surprise too. And of course, they want to, get away from that, because they could potentially, if they don't relieve that pressure, they could, what they do call is blevy, and explode. I personally did not witness that. I don't believe that happened, but, you know, they're just starting to begin the investigation right now. So until they get in there and actually sift through the debris, we won't know that.
Say there was a limited supply of chemical in the chemical warehouse. Had this happened any other time?
No, no. No.
Had this happened any other time, like during the middle of the season?
We would have had a lot more inventory in there, yes. Yeah, yeah.
Would this have created a bigger danger in your
Well, certainly a bigger environmental concern, yeah. As far as the actual chemicals, I mean, there's really no danger as far as explosive in these chemicals. They're farm chemicals used to kill weeds, some insecticides for killing insects. Again, you know, this spring planting is our big time for gearing up in that department. So the warehouses are relatively empty this time of year, and we began filling them again during the course of the winter. But yeah, if it was going to be a good time to happen, which of course is never a good time to happen, you know, we had a limited amount of inventory at least, you know, that would. And we, our biggest concern, you know, in our contingency planning is environmental, you know, after, you know, building is unoccupied, we don't run multiple shifts. This time of the year, you know, there was no occupancy in there, so there was no concern about, you know, human occupancy in there. But our concern would be environmental damage, environmental runoff from the farm chemicals. And then we also had, there's some storage tanks down there. They're liquid nitrogen. You know, it's a nitrogen for a corn crop. And those were empty. All of them were empty except for one had 75 ton of liquid nitrogen in it. So, you know, and those, you know, were near the fire, but, you know, it's our belief that they haven't... they weren't damaged by the fire. But again, we haven't gone in to investigate at this point in time.
Now, is the entire co-op damaged, or is
just our what we would consider our agronomy facility, and it was in the northwest portion of the cooperative. And the main office, the feed mill, the grain elevator, our shop, our maintenance shop was untouched. There was some damage to our main dry fertilizer plant storage facility. That basically looks to me like it's limited to just some vinyl siding melted. Because that was the nearest building to the fire.
And how much would that make up of the entire plant? Is that, you know, 50% of the plant?
Well, as far as the actual physical facilities, about one-third of the facilities.
How many people work at the plant?
We have, out of that department, about 10 people. You know, it's seasonal business, so during, you know, April, May, June, there would be, a lot more people working there. But this time of year, about 10 people. Total, we have 25 employees and, full-time employees and about a half a dozen part-time seasonal employees.
Are they going to be able to go back to work anytime soon?
Well, right now our feed mill is functioning yet. Our grain elevator is functioning. We do have power, to our feed mill. I think there's power still cut to the rest of the cooperative. Our maintenance shop has power down there. So, you know, this time of the year, the part of our business would be impacted. We do some, some weed spraying at this time of the year. You know, that facility is obviously been destroyed, where we load our spray rigs up and put the chemicals in, and also where we treat our wheat seed, and our wheat seed inventory that the farmers will be planting now in the next month has been destroyed down there too.
Was somebody on site there? Is that how that this was discovered?
There's a whey factory next door, and they do run 24/7, and one of their employees called the fire in.
Obviously this could have been so much worse, but tell us how devastating it still is.
Well, obviously it's, it has a big impact on our business. Again, it's a time of the year where it's not as big, because that facility is really extremely important to us, as the farmers are planting their corn and beans and their spring, crops. So this time of the year, we still have quite a bit going on down there, but, it's not as critical as it would be in the springtime. But, it certainly has an economic impact on us, so. And on we're a farm cooperative, so we're owned by our farmer members that do business with the cooperative. So it certainly has an impact, on our farm members also. So.
Can any of you say and spell your first and last name? And
Jerry, J-E-R-R-Y, and then Like, spelled L-E-I-C-K.
And what's your title?
I'm general manager of the Adel Cooperative. General manager.
Did you say there is, in fact, environmental concerns with those insecticides?
Well, yes, because we don't want them to, with ending up in a local stream, anytime you have any kind of chemical at all. So, the fire department diked up. We have two 24-inch culverts that run. The drainage pretty much all goes northwest off our property down to that corner where the fire was. There's a fairly large drainage ditch on the north end of the property. So they dammed up, they diked up the culverts that go off our property. And right now they do have a vacuum truck coming in to start recovering water from that ditch. So yeah, the concern, of course, is environmental contamination from the farm chemicals.
And just to clarify, you said there was an explosion, or there was?
Well, what's reported as explosion, I guess I would say it was the propane tanks relieving the pressure, because these have pressure relief valves on that are, I think, maybe set to relieve at 350 PSI. So as that fire, those tanks are right up against the building, one of the buildings that was on fire. They're 120-gallon upright tanks, about that big around. And as that building, the wood structures that they were burning, they heated up the tank, it heats up that propane in there, it starts boiling in there, creates pressure in that steel vessel, and they're designed to vent like that and then ignite. So if it doesn't ignite, you could build up propane and have an explosion, but I think those tanks did what they're designed to do. There were big torches going up as that pressure was relieved. They burnt that propane off up into the air. But very loud and very scary if you're standing down there fighting that fire.
They'll finish the investigation, and then do you think about rebuilding, or kind of what do you
guys
do?
Right, we do have a board of directors that make those type of decisions for the cooperative, and obviously we'll be meeting with them this week yet and decide what our plan is from here. Yes, and our biggest concern right now would be to limit the environmental damage and get it cleaned up after the investigation of the fire is over. And this time, investigation is not even started, really, so we have...
Ballpark fit here as far as damage here?
I really don't at this point in time. So
is there anything you can say to residents? I mean, are there things that they should avoid? I don't know.
Well, I think maybe, Will maybe could address that better. I know they have been checking air quality. That would be the concern, because there is some chemicals down there. Again, a small amount of extremely hazardous farm insecticides in a dry form. If they would be burning that smoke, you would not want to be breathing that. So they had been monitoring air quality, which they felt was, again, Will could address that for you. But that would be the concern, would be air quality. Can I answer any other questions for you?
Can you say your last name again? I'm sorry.
Like.
So, Chief, can you talk a little bit about the air quality?
Sure. this morning, as the scene progressed, we had the hazmat team down there doing air quality checks. They came back low at this time. As far as the specifics, I can have our hazmat team representative answer those questions. Right now, the levels are low enough that the residents were allowed to return to their homes. And the fire is under control, and the building is on the ground right now, so it's kind of a wait and see at this point.
Unsafe at some point? Were they higher earlier this morning?
Right now, I don't know if a test ever came back high. It was done as a precautionary measure, as along with the evacuation of all the residents that were being affected by the smoke. The evacuation was done just in case, because we didn't know at that time exactly the chemicals that were being stored on site in particular at that point. So we just went ahead and did an evacuation, not knowing.
What can you tell me about the cause of the fire at this point? You know why it started?
We don't know what the cause of the fire is. The Sheboygan County Fire Investigation Team's on scene, and they're doing a full investigation in conjunction with the hazmat team. We're kind of waiting for the site to become safe for the investigators to kind of get in there and start sifting through the debris.
Can you tell me where the complex started?
The fire would be located on the north end of the complex.
Inside that warehouse somewhere that the actual fire began?
We're unsure as to where the origin of the fire was at this point.
You talked about one minor injury to a firefighter. Can you elaborate on that, and were there any others?
As far as I know, we only had one injury. It was a minor injury. A firefighter suffered a sprained ankle, and I don't believe that they were transported, so... Other than that, everything was, everybody did good.
Of course, as Mike pointed out, they're never a good time for this type of thing, but in light of the season and the light of stuff that's normally kept there, did you catch a break? Did everybody, did this town catch a break from that?
I definitely think that, it definitely could have been worse. So given the circumstances, I think that everything went very well, along with the response from our neighboring fire departments. I think overall the scene went extremely smoothly. Along with our box alarm system that we run, we had 15 other fire departments responding. with various equipment, including a couple of fire departments from Ozaukee County. We also had the hazmat team respond, the county investigation team. City of Sheboygan brought their incident command vehicle and the Red Cross.
What were the residents notified about to be evacuated?
Given the circumstances, as fire department personnel, we weren't able to handle that kind of a task. The sheriff's department took care of evacuating the residents.
Ballpark, about how many firefighters on scene?
Ballpark, I would say probably about 200.
A real test for your guys, knowing that when you were facing inside, you had all sorts of potential accelerants in there. I mean, explain what you guys were looking at potentially when you were fighting
there. As far as a breathing standpoint, there's not a whole lot of danger. We operate on an SCBA. It's a self-contained breathing bottles that we carry. Once the tanks started to vent off, that was the concern. As possible explosions. At that point, that was our main concern. If one of those tanks would have exploded, it could have potentially sent any shrapnel or anything in any direction. So.
But you can just say and spell your first and last name.
My first name is Will, W-I-L-L, and my last name is Schneiderwent, S-C-H-N-E-I-D-E-R-W-E-N-T.
Smoke was quite heavy, and sure.
Just for the record, give us your name, please.
Andy, A-N-D-Y, Schmidt, S-C-H-M-I-T-T.
And you are?
Village president.
Village president.
Yes.
Roughly about half the population out of how many did you see?
There's about 502, I would say, is what the sign says. So I would say half the population. Anywhere south of County Trunk BB, the decision was made to evacuate. Having no power, the sheriff's department went door to door, and we made the decision to send everybody to the Random Lake High School, our local school system.
At that time of morning, probably waking everybody up out of bed.
We were banging on doors, right, recommending that people would leave the village.
You ever had to do that before here?
No. I don't want it again. No.
How concerned were the residents?
General confusion, confusion on my part when they decided to make that decision. People were asking where they should go, and I said, well, I'll go to the mini mart first, and then we decided to send them to the high school in Random Lake, about 5 miles south of here.
Status of the fire right now, how's it look?
Status of the fire right now is the fire is almost completely out. At this point, we're trying to use as little water as possible to prevent the runoff of whatever chemicals are still left on site. The fire is basically at this point extinguishing itself, and the building is a complete loss, so it's all on the ground.